Some strange results have come up in about the last 20, 30 years, particularly in astronomy and also in quantum physics, which suggests that the universe actually may have a purpose, and some physicists are now suggesting it does have a purpose. And this has come out of some findings about the atomic, some of the fundamental numbers in atomic physics.
During the past 40 years, scientists have determined the relative strengths of each of these primary laws and forces. These strengths are so critically balanced, they are often described as being finely tuned.
These are numbers like the mass, the weight of an electron, the weight of a quark, the strength of gravity, the strength of the electromagnetic field. About 20 numbers that describe those and other parameters, features of our world, but nobody knows why it is that those numbers have the particular values that they do. Now, you could easily say, yeah, who really cares? You change the mass of the electron by a little bit more, a little bit less, does it really matter? And the answer is it does. See, it turns out that if you imagine that we had 20 dials right here, and we could fiddle with those 20 numbers at will, even a small change to the values of the known values of those numbers would cause the world as we know it to disappear.
Because it turns out, and this is a very surprising, unexpected discovery, that the laws of physics, the basic given fabric of the world, had to be very specific, very finely tuned, as we sometimes say, for the possibility of carbon-based life appearing at all.
For example, the strengths of the other forces are all important, the masses of the various subatomic particles. Now, this is one of a long list of properties in underlying physics that seem to be prerequisites for a universe with life. If all of these things were even a little bit different, then life, certainly life as we know it, could not exist.
It's a very surprising conclusion, but it's true, and all scientists would acknowledge that's the case.
Bernard Carr is a cosmologist and studies how the laws of physics operate in the universe. He says that the laws of nature are so finely tuned to enable complex life to exist that it is extremely unlikely that this could have happened by chance. Such fine tuning, Carr believes, at least raises the possibility of a tuner.
This is a diagram, it's called the pyramid of complexity, and what we've got here, we've got the different levels of structure in the universe, and at the bottom we've got the things like quarks that make up the atoms, and the atoms build up to make molecules, the molecules build up to make living cells, the cells make organisms, and eventually we end up with brains and consciousness. It's rather hard to estimate what the probability is, but it was clearly very, very unlikely that those fine tunings which allowed this pyramid of complexity to arise would be there.
A very simple and central example is the question of where does carbon come from? The very early universe doesn't make any carbon. It's very simple, it only makes simple things. Hydrogen and helium, they're pretty boring in terms of chemistry. Now, where does carbon come from? There's only one place in the whole universe where carbon is made. It's in the interior nuclear furnaces of the stars. We are people of stardust, made of the ashes of dead stars. And it turns out that the process by which carbon is made inside the stars is an extraordinarily delicate process. In fact, it looked at first sight as though it couldn't happen at all. It's only possible because there's a very large enhancement effect, called a resonance in the tray, which makes it go much quicker than we might have expected. And that resonance is there because the laws of nuclear physics take a very specific form. If they were a little bit different, either there would be no resonance or it would be in the wrong place at the wrong energy. That's a very striking example of how finely tuned the universe has to be for us to be inhabitants of it.
The fine tunings, how fine tuned are they? Most of them are 1% sort of things. In other words, if a thing is 1% different, everything is bad. And a physicist could say, maybe those are just luck. On the other hand, this cosmological constant is tuned to one part and 10 to the 120, 120 decimal places. Nobody thinks that's accidental. That is not a reasonable idea, that something is tuned to 120 decimal places just by accident. That's the most extreme example of fine-tuning.
No force in the history of cosmology has ever been discovered to be that finely tuned. The cosmological constant needs to be set to one part in a trillion, 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 Otherwise the universe would be so drastically different that it would be impossible for us to evolve. That the cosmological constant arrived at such a tiny value by chance seemed to be out of the question.
Ils sont nombreux à dire que finalement, quand on regarde l'univers, surtout à l'origine, eh bien, on constate qu'il ne peut pas être né par hasard, et que le hasard n'a aucun rôle, et que plus on remonte loin dans le temps, donc plus on remonte vers le Big Bang, plus on trouve un univers qui est ordonné, réglé, ajusté.
For example, if we go back to say 1 second after the Big Bang, at that point the expansion rate and the mass density have to have been adjusted to each other just right, so that the universe is just at this critical point. If the universe at that point were expanding just one part in the 15th decimal place faster, the universe would have flown apart without galaxies ever having had a chance to form. On the other hand, if the expansion rate were just a little slower than what we think by change of one in the 15th decimal place, then the universe would in fact have expanded to a maximum size and collapsed. We would never have even reached the time in the universe at which we're living.
Alors, ajuster comment? Eh bien, il existe ce qu'on appelle des paramètres cosmologiques. Ce sont des grandes constantes, la constante de la vitesse de la lumière, par exemple, qui fait 300 000 km à la seconde, 7 fois donc le tour de la Terre en une seconde. Il y a la constante de gravitation. Ce sont des chiffres, des données chiffrées, avec un zéro, une virgule, et puis parfois des dizaines de décimales derrière la virgule. Eh bien, si on changeait simplement une seule de ces décimales sur une seule de ces 20 constantes, l'univers ne pourrait pas apparaître. Eh bien, ça signifie que le hasard n'a aucun rôle à jouer à l'origine de l'univers.
How did this come about, this rather terrific luck? Of course, one of the first explanations that comes to mind is that there was a tuner or a creator, or if you like, God. And obviously for people of a theological disposition, the idea that the fine-tuning is evidence of God, of course, is wonderful.
Let me come now to the grand design, because like every other physicist, Carl King is confronted with powerful evidence of design in the fine-tuning of the universe. He explains, our universe and its laws appear to have a design that both is tailor-made to support us, and if we are to exist, leaves little room for alteration. That is not easily explained, and raises the natural question of why it is that way. The discovery relatively recently of the extreme fine-tuning of so many of the laws of nature could lead at least some of us back to the old idea that this grand design is the work of some grand designer. That is not the answer of modern science. Our universe seems to be one of many, each with different laws. Now, the idea of a grand designer is certainly old, but the important question to ask is whether or not it is true. Simply to say it is old can give the erroneous impression that what is old is necessarily false and has been superseded. Secondly, it can give the further erroneous impression that no one holds it today. But some of the finest minds in science, at least one Nobel Prize winner in physics, does hold it. The conviction that there is a grand designer is one of the major convictions in the history of human thought. That does not, of course, prove it's true, but it certainly means it's worthy of our serious consideration. Now, Hawking goes therefore too far in saying that is not the answer of modern science. There are scientists who believe it, there are scientists who do not. But his answer is what he calls the multiverse. And that is the idea that there are several many world scenarios and many universes, some suggest infinitely many, whatever that means. That anything that can happen will happen in some universe, so it's not surprising that at least one universe is like ours.
Well, obviously if you're not a theist, and especially if you're a person who would prefer the universe to be a godless sort of universe, those are the sorts of facts that can make you feel a little bit uncomfortable. So there's no shortage of persons trying to derail the argument from fine-tuning. One popular way to try and do that is to take the fine tuning data, not so much to suggest that there's a God who made this universe, but that perhaps our universe is one of bajillions of others. If you think about a multiverse, if you think that there are jillions and jillions of universes out there, you might reason to yourself that, well, at least one of them had to turn out right. And it just so happens to be ours, lucky for us. So multiple universe theory, incidentally, you can see on the October 2005 edition of Astronomy Magazine, cover story, Why You Live in Multiple Universes. If you see all these little marble-looking things over the cover, those are literal universes expanding much as ours is. Interesting, that cover title seems to take for granted that there actually are multiple universes. There have to be in order to get this sort of probability back up. Well, suffice to say, there's really no independent confirmation for multiple universes or for any universe other than ours. The only reason for buying into a multiple universe theory is to derail the fine-tuning argument. Some, including Oxford philosopher of religion Richard Swinburne, have said multiple universe theory represents the height of irrationality. It's an attempt to dodge a rather elegant and simple theory, namely theism, by inflating your probabilistic resources, well, to the extent of postulating bajillions of universes. When you start to increase your probabilistic resources like that just in order to avoid a pretty plausible, elegant theory, well, Bill Dembski has referred to that as the inflationary fallacy, and there's still some discussion going on with respect to the plausibility of the multiple universe theory. Probably the number one objection to it, there seems to be no independent evidence and no possibility of coming up with such independent evidence for that hypothesis in the future.
In the various ways that are conceived of these many universes existing, it's the case that they are unobservable in principle. The only universe we can observe is this one. These other universes cannot be observed even in principle.
One problem is this. Sure, you could say if there were many different universes all with different tunings, then it wouldn't be too unlikely that our particularly fine-tuned universe exists. But for this objection to carry through, the objector actually needs to assume that it's true that there are all of these different universes. And is there any independent evidence that such universes exist? It doesn't seem to me the case that there is. I mean, sure, if you had enough monkeys typing at enough typewriters, then they could produce the works of William Shakespeare just by luck. But nobody looks at the work of William Shakespeare and goes, ah, there must be a lot of monkeys with typewriters somewhere. In the absence of independent evidence that there is a whole typing pool of monkeys working away, everyone knows that the most rational explanation of the specified complexity of a text like Shakespeare's work is that there was a single designer who produced it intentionally. And the same thing goes for our universe.
So now we come to the second set of false alternatives, God of the multiverse. But as leading philosophers have pointed out, from a theoretical perspective, why shouldn't God be responsible for the multiverse? The notion that there is a multiverse does not per se exclude a creator. Hawking doesn't seem to mention this at all. But with the multiverse, Hawking moves out beyond science into the realm of philosophy, whose death he has announced rather prematurely. As Paul Davis points out, all cosmological models are constructed by augmenting the results of observation by some sort of philosophical principle. Now, Hawking here claiming to be the voice of modern science on the issue gives a false impression where the multiverse is concerned, since there are very weighty voices within science that do not support his view. Prominent among them, Sir Roger Penrose, Hawking's former collaborator, who shared with him the distinguished Wolf Prize. Of Hawking's use of the multiverse concept in The Grand Design, Penrose recently said, "It's overused, and this is a place where it's overused. It's an excuse for not having a good theory." That's an immensely strong statement, isn't it?
La densité de l'univers, par exemple, doit être réglée à une précision de 10 puissance moins 60, donc qui est égale à la précision qu'un archer doit exercer, si vous voulez planter une flèche, dans une cible de 1 cm carré, donc comme ça, tout petit comme ça, mais qui sera placé au bord de l'univers à 14 milliards d'années.
À l'autre bout.
Oui, c'est ça. Vous voyez, donc une précision extrême. Hein, c'est vraiment. Alors donc la question, est-ce qu'il y a un principe créateur, quelque chose qui règle les choses dès le début, ou, donc ça c'est la nécessité, ou c'est le pur hasard. Mais le pur hasard, quand il y a une probabilité si faible pour que ça aboutisse, il faut donc faire l'hypothèse qu'il y a une infinité d'univers. Si vous jouez la loterie, si vous achetez tous les billets, bien sûr, il y aura un qui aura le gros lot. Donc ici, si vous avez une infinité d'univers, ce qu'on appelle un multivers, chacun ayant une combinaison différente de constantes physiques et de conditions initiales, la plupart sera vide de vie parce que la combinaison des constantes physiques ne sera pas gagnante, sauf dans le nôtre où nous avons la combinaison gagnante.
Si vous croyez à cette hypothèse multivers, ou vous voyez plutôt un univers prédéterminé?
Donc je réponds en tant qu'être humain maintenant, pas en tant que scientifique, parce que la science peut admettre des multivers aussi.
J'aimerais avoir votre avis, oui. En fait, votre intuition.
Voilà, donc j'appelle ça mon pari pascalien, et bien sûr je pense que l'univers est... Il y a un principe créateur qui a réglé ça tout le début, et je pense qu'il y a un univers unique, parce que c'est mon intuition, c'est difficile de croire quand je vais au télescope par exemple, de voir toute cette harmonie, cette beauté, cette organisation, de croire que tout est hasard, que rien n'a de sens et que nous sommes là par hasard, que toute cette architecture cosmique est faite par hasard.